Listening Library presents Who Was Harriet Tubman? By Yona Zeldis McDonough. Read for you by Adenrele Ojo. Who Was Harriet Tubman? No one knows the exact year in which Harriet Tubman was born. It may have been 1820 or 1821. Most people didn't think the birth of an enslaved person was worth remembering. Harriet Tubman would grow into a brave and daring young woman. She was brave enough to escape from slavery. She was daring enough to help others escape too. Because she led so many to freedom, she was called Moses. Like Moses in the Bible, Harriet Tubman believed that her people should be free, and she risked her life many times to help them become free. Even after she had escaped safely from the South, she went back to take other slaves north to freedom. Here is her story. Chapter 1. Life in Maryland. Sometime around 1820 in Maryland, an enslaved woman named Harriet Ross gave birth to a baby girl. Neither Harriet, who was called Old Writ, nor her husband, Ben, could read or write, so they couldn't record the year of the baby's birth. No one else thought it was worth doing, but Old Writ loved her tiny child and wanted to protect her. She hoped her little girl, whose nickname was Minty, would learn to sew, cook, or weave. Then she could avoid the back-breaking work, picking crops like tobacco, corn, or wheat in the fields. Old Writ and Ben had been born into slavery. They had many children, all of whom were also enslaved. Ever since 1619, when black people from Africa were kidnapped and brought on slave ships to Virginia, slavery had been a part of American life. By the early 1800s, most of the northern states had stopped slavery, but the southern states had not. Enslaved people like Ben and Old Writ worked very hard, yet they were not paid for their work. Instead, Ben and Old Writ lived on land owned by their enslaver, a man named Mr. Brodus. This land and the many buildings on it was called a plantation. Mr. Brodus's plantation house was large and grand, like so many of those in the South. Ben and Old Writ could see the Brodus's big house every day, but they didn't live there. They lived in a log cabin, like the other enslaved people on the plantation. These cabins were very small. They had no windows. The floors were made of dirt. Piles of worn-out blankets were the only beds. Still, for little Minty, this was home. As soon as she could walk, Minty joined her brothers and sisters and other enslaved children who were watched by an older slave. The littlest children weren't forced to work, yet. There were even times when Minty and the other children could play and have fun. Summers were warm and bright. They swam and fished in the many streams and creeks. Unlike many enslaved children, Minty lived with her loving parents. Her father told her stories about the woods. He could name the birds. He knew which berries were sweet and tasty. Bought and sold. Groups of black men, women, and children were kidnapped from West Africa and brought to the United States. Here, they were sold at auction to the person who bid the highest amount of money for them. Auctions were advertised with signs and newspaper ads. Before the auction, white people looked over the black people who were for sale. They pried open their mouths to check their teeth. They pinched their arms and legs to test their muscles. Auctions tore apart families. A mother might be sold to a plantation owner in Mississippi, while her son or daughter might be sold to a plantation owner in Louisiana. The two would never see each other again. Husbands and wives, parents and children, brothers and sisters were cruelly separated. In 1859, a plantation owner named Pierce M. Butler sold 436 slaves over 2 days to pay off money he owed. It was the largest slave auction on record in the United States, and it was called The Weeping Time. Minty's mother told her stories from the Bible. From her mother, Minty learned about Moses. Moses had lived thousands of years before. He led his people, the Hebrews, out of Egypt, where they had been slaves and into freedom. Around 1826, when Minty turned six, her life changed. Mr. Brodus hired her out. This meant that she had to leave her parents and her home. She had to go live and work for white people who could not afford to buy a slave of their own. The day she had to leave, a wagon came to take her away. Minty did not want to go. Her two older sisters had been sent away. She remembered how they cried and cried. But they had to go anyway. So did Minty. Minty worked for a woman named Mrs. Cook. Mrs. Cook was a weaver. She spent her days in front of a big, noisy loom. Minty helped her wind the yarn. The air was filled with fuzz and lint. It made Minty cough. She couldn't concentrate. She dropped the yarn. Mrs. Cook got angry. When she was angry, she would punish Minty by whipping her. Enslaved people were often beaten or whipped. Mrs. Cook told her husband that Minty was stupid and slow. So Mr. Cook had her help him instead. He was trying to catch muskrats. He set out traps by the river. It was Minty's job to watch them. It was cold near the river. One day, Minty woke up feeling sick. Mrs. Cook thought she was pretending so she wouldn't have to work. Just as always, Mr. Cook sent Minty out to check the traps. She went down to the river, shivering from fever. When she got back, Mrs. Cook saw that she was really sick. She sent Minty home to her parents to get well. Old Rit took care of Minty for 6 weeks, but then it was back to Mrs. Cook in the loom. Minty could not do the job. The cook sent her home again. Next, Mr. Brodus hired Minty out to a woman named Miss Susan. Minty, who was only about seven, had to watch Miss Susan's baby. If the baby cried, Minty was whipped. At night, she sat by the baby's cradle. She rocked it gently. But Minty was tired. She would fall asleep and the baby would begin to cry. Then Miss Susan would get angry at being woken, and Minty was whipped again. Minty learned to stay alert for the baby, but it was hard. She was always tired. Once, when Miss Susan's back was turned, Minty reached for a lump of sugar that was in a bowl on the table. She had never tasted sugar. It looked so good. But Miss Susan saw her. Furious, she reached for the whip. Minty was too fast. Out the door she flew. She did not stop running until she was sure Miss Susan was no longer chasing her. But now what? If she went back, she would face a whipping. Minty found a pig pen. She crawled inside to hide. She was very young, but she was bold. She tried to fight the piglets for potato peelings and other scraps of food, but the mother pig pushed Minty away. After 5 days, Minty was filthy and starving. She knew she would have to return to Miss Susan. Later, Minty would say, "I didn't have anywhere else to go, even though I knew what was coming." Nat Turner's Rebellion. Born around 1800, Nat Turner was a slave in Southampton County, Virginia. When he was little, his mother told him that he would one day lead his people to freedom, like Moses in the Bible. Turner believed what his mother had told him. He grew up to be a preacher. People called him the prophet, which means teacher. On August 20th, 1831, there was an eclipse of the sun. Turner took this as a sign that it was time to rebel. He led a band of enslaved people from plantation to plantation, killing the whites they met. Wherever they stopped, more people joined them. Soon, 70 rebel slaves had killed a total of 60 white people. The rebellion was broken up with the help of federal troops, but Turner stayed hidden in a cave for 2 months. Later, he was found, and on November 11, 1831, Nat Turner was executed. Instead of being hired out again, Minty was sent back to...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.